This video is about the CNC 3018 router. It's a fun little machine that can be picked up for under $200. In this video, I'm going to assemble the machine step by step, and then I'm going to test it extensively in wood, plastic and aluminium. If you follow the steps in my video, you should be able to have the machine up and running within an hour. I made timestamps in the description to help you navigate through this video. Skip or revisit parts as much as you like. When the package is opened and you see this soft squishy foam and not the more common styrofoam, you should close the package, turn it around and open it from the other side. If you did unpack the package with the right side up, it should look something like this. The first thing that caught my eye was that the aluminium extruded profiles were from much higher quality than I had expected. I had a bad experience with this kind of profiles with my other CNC router, but the profiles from this machine seem to be much heavier and straighter. What I didn't realize when I saw this kit online was that some of the parts are 3D printed. If the prints are from high quality, this should work just fine. We have to be careful that we don't tighten the bolts on these parts too much, because the 3D printed parts are hollow from the inside. Putting too much force on the parts will crush them. The overall print quality seems to be high and I don't see too many imperfections. The instruction manual has some pictures with dimensions, but it doesn't have a clear step-by-step approach that we can follow. Before we're going to start building, it's a good thing to take a look at the different screws and bolts. This kit uses the T-slot in the extruded aluminium profiles in combination with these T-slot fasteners. The whole machine uses about 60 of them, so it's important to know how to use them before you start building. There are several ways to work with these T-nuts. My preferred method goes the following way. The screw and the T-nuts need to be pre-installed in the part we want to assemble. It's important that the T-nut is screwed on only a couple of threads, so it's still nice and loose. Once you inserted the T-nut in the rail, you can see there's plenty of space between the bolt head and your aluminium profile. This space is going to help us with getting the T-nut rotated correctly. When we start turning the screw, the nut rotates along and gets stuck in the T-slot. You don't need to turn on the screw with much force. When you feel that the screw is getting tight, a small last turn is enough. If you look carefully, you can see that the nut didn't turn a full 90 degrees. You can try to adjust it further with a small screwdriver, but in my opinion this is a waste of time. There's not much force applied on the frame of this machine, and with the nut rotated about 45 degrees, you should be fine. To keep things simple, I marked all the fastening material used in this video with a number. We start with pre-installing number 1 T-nuts with number 2 screws on all the ankle brackets and support brackets. Now it's time to start building the bottom part of the machine. It's called frame number 1 in the manual. We need 3 times the 360mm and 2 times the 330mm profiles. We start with the 2 shorter profiles on the outside and the longer one in the middle. 2 corner brackets are used to join them together. To get the machine as accurate as possible, it's important that the profiles are positioned correctly before you fasten the screws. I like to use a straight piece of material to help align the profiles. In this case, the shortest profile from the set. By positioning the extra piece of material like you see in the picture, you get a good connection every time. I use one hand to press the 3 profiles together, and that keeps my other hand free to use the screwdriver. When you use this method, most of the times the profiles are aligned perfectly. It's possible that there's a small gap here. This can easily be fixed by placing the frame on the table like this and then slightly loosen the upper screw. The profiles will fall in place and you can tighten the screw again. The next step is to add the second 360mm profile and place it tightly against the 2 corner brackets from the previous step. Attach it with 2 more corner brackets. The third 360mm profile is placed against the opposite side. Again, use the trick with the extra piece of material to help with alignment. The first frame is now finished and we are ready to start with frame number 2. The two 220mm profiles are placed on the outside and the remaining two 360mm profiles in the middle. Four corner brackets are used to join everything together. Use the trick with the extra piece of material to make sure everything is aligned correctly. Because the 220mm profile is not available anymore, you can use another part like the profile used for the machine bed. The two frames are now finished. We're not going to join them just yet, but we are going to install the ankle brackets for this step. Doing this right now makes things much easier near the end of the build. To get the ankle brackets at 84mm like the drawing suggests, you position the two remaining profiles like this, and then the brackets can be secured. The machine bed is made from the two remaining profiles. They are joined with two aluminium strips. The first two guide rails can now be installed on the machine bed. The manual shows us that the two guide rails need to be 160mm apart and that the center of the support bracket needs to be 70mm from the top side of the middle profile. Because the length of the middle profile is 360mm instead of 300, we're going to make the distance between the support rails 220mm. The four linear bearings are placed on the bottom of the machine bed and the two shortest guide rails are inserted. To get the 220mm spacing between the support rails, the bearings need to be 35mm from the side of the machine bed, measured from the green line. If you precisely measure 35mm and then tighten the bearings in place, there's a high chance the rails are not going to slide easily like they should. This is because we are not working with high precision parts here. To get the rails to slide freely, we start with positioning one bearing 35mm from the side. Make sure it's positioned straight and tight it down. Move the support rail up and down a couple of times. The second bearing that is still loose will move itself in the correct place, and it's ready to be tightened down as well. The support rail should now slide easily through the bearings. If you look from above and everything looks good, we can go to the next step. If the rails are not parallel or don't move freely, you have to redo this step until you got it right. The holder for the lead screw is now placed between the two support rails. Insert a spring onto the brass nut and insert it in the holder. Keep the spring under tension and insert the shortest of the two lead screws. Keep feeding it in until it exits from the other side. Four support brackets are slid on the rails and the machine bed assembly is placed on frame number one. With a screwdriver, the T-nuts can be rotated to let them fit in the rails. When you make sure that the machine bed assembly is in the middle of the frame, the first support bracket can be tightened. Move the bed back and forth a couple of times and secure the second bracket from the same support rail. Again, move the bed a couple of times and secure the third bracket. Repeat this one more time for the last bracket and the bed should now be able to move smoothly on the rails. If this isn't the case, loosen all brackets again and redo this step. Slide the lead screw bearing over the lead screw and put it in place, without tightening it just yet. This part uses the shorter screw indicated with number 3 in the picture. Place the steel motor bracket over the motor and secure it with the 4 number 4 screws. Make sure that the longer side of the bracket faces away from the white connector, like you can see in the picture. With the T-nuts and the number 3 screws, the motor is placed in front of the lead screw. Lightly tighten the bracket to the frame and install the blue coupler to the lead screw and the motor shaft. The manual tells us to only tighten the screws on one side of the coupler. I followed this step and the coupler works okay. I don't know the exact reason why this is advised, but if your coupler starts to slip, feel free to ignore this step and tighten all the screws. Make sure not to apply too much force because the screws and the screw threads are very fragile. Loosen the screws that attach the motor to the frame so the motor can still be moved. Turn the lead screw until the machine bed is moved all the way to the lead screw bearing. The bearing can now be secured to the frame. Turn the lead screw the opposite direction until the bed is near the motor. Now secure the motor to the frame. Check all the screws one more time and make sure the lead screw can be turned without too much force. The process we used for frame 1 is now used for frame number 2. The brushed lead screw nut with the spring is inserted in the spindle assembly. The spring is kept under tension and the lead screw is inserted until it exits from the other end. The two remaining support rails are inserted and 4 support brackets are slid on the end of the rails. The spindle assembly is placed on the frame and the hex screws from the support brackets can now be tightened. With the help of the last motor bracket, the 2 top support brackets are held in the correct place and secured to the frame. The spindle assembly is moved to the left and the left bottom support bracket is fastened. Now the spindle assembly is moved to the right and the right bottom bracket is fastened. The motor bracket is installed on the motor with number 4 screws. For this motor, the side that sticks out is now on the same side as the white cable connector. With the T-nuts and screws number 3, the motor is placed in front of the lead screw. The blue motor coupling is installed and tightened on one side. With the spindle assembly positioned to the left side of the frame, the last lead screw bearing is secured with a T-nut and number 3 screws. The motor screws are loosened and the spindle assembly is moved to the right side of the frame. The motor can now be fastened again. The motor coupling from the Z-axis of my machine probably came loose during shipping. Make sure to check this coupling on your machine as well. The 2 frames can now be joined together. Because we already installed the corner brackets in the correct place, we only have to fasten the 2 top screws from the brackets. The 3D printed supports can now be installed. Use the T-nuts with the number 3 screws. The PCB with the Arduino and the stepper drivers are attached to this piece of acrylic. Use bolts, nuts and washers number 5, 6 and 7. If you look closely on the PCB, you can see that the connectors from each stepper driver are marked with X, Y and Z. The first connector for my PCB is for the X axis. The second is for the Y axis. The second Y axis connector stays unused and the last connector is for the Z axis. The wires from the spindle motor can now be attached. The positive lead on the motor is indicated with a red dot. Attach the red wire to this lead and the black wire to the other lead. The other side of the spindle cable is inserted in the connector on the PCB indicated with CNC out 2. The 24V power supply is plugged in the connector indicated with 12 to 36 volts. And the last cable is the Arduino USB cable. When the board is powered on, you should hear the step motors come to life with this sound. The Gerbil software that is used with this machine can be found on the Banggood product page. When the software is installed and everything is hooked up correctly, you should be able to move the machine with the jockeys. Under the jockeys, you can select the presets. Select the lower preset value for small jog movements and the higher preset value for the large movements. Now we got the machine up and running, it's time for the first engraving. I used the engraving bit and the brass coupler for this first test. There was some laminate flooring left from my laser engraver video that was perfect for this first cut.
The engraving itself went really well. The machine performed perfectly. The only problem was that text was engraved upside down and it's also engraved in mirror image. To fix this, we need to invert the travel direction from the X and the Y axis. Checking the travel direction for the X axis is pretty straightforward. If you push X plus, you should see the Virtual 2 and the software move to the right. Pushing X minus and the Virtual 2 should move to the left. The spindle should match the movements from the software. For the Z-axis, it's the same thing. For the Y-axis, it's somewhat counterintuitive. When pushing the Y plus key, the Virtual 2 moves forward, but the machine bed should move backwards. When pushing the Y minus key, the Virtual 2 moves backwards, but the machine should move forward. If one or more axes are inverted, you can fix this by typing the following command to the Kerbal console. Let's say the X and Y axes are inverted. We use the command $2 equals 3, and now it's fixed. The engraver is now working properly. Let's try an engraving in acrylic. Before we proceed with testing, I'm going to replace this original brass coupler with this much more solid color chuck. This chuck works with precision spring collets that come in metric and imperial sizes. With the use of two wrenches, the tool can be secured. The machine will perform better with this upgrade due to more solid connection between the tool and the spindle. Also, the heads of the small black Allen screws from the original coupler are doomed to get stripped after a couple of times. By buying this upgrade with your machine, you will be safe from this headache. With this 1/8 inch double flute end mill, I tried milling some MDF board. The result was promising. The machine held an accuracy of 0.2 mm, which is not bad at all for such a cheap machine. After testing several settings, I found out that a feed rate of 250 mm a minute with a 0.5 mm deep and a 3 mm wide cut work really well with this M-Mill and the MDF board. This rocket shape came out perfect and the surface finish looked good. Also, a larger cut in the MDF board went well. The last test on the MDF board was making this lever with the triangle shapes in it. After that, I tried a much harder kind of wood. I tried the same rocket shape with the same settings as the cut in the MDF. It also came out perfect. Now it's time to push the machine much further. I want to find out if it's possible to cut aluminium and get somewhat of a good result. I tried the same rocket shape program I used for the MDF and multiplex board, with only a slower entry in the material. I suspected that these settings would be too aggressive for the much harder aluminium, but I tried it anyway. The machine didn't like this operation at all. It was cutting really bad with the end mill jumping and deflecting on the material. After 30 seconds I stopped the program. I lowered the settings and this was the result. We can conclude that it is possible to cut aluminium on this machine. Although it would take forever to get even a small workpiece done, it can be a fun experience to try. With higher quality end mill, the result will improve somewhat, but don't expect too much out of it. Overall, I enjoyed working with this fun little machine. I think it's a great first machine for people that have zero experience with CNC machining and want to find out if CNC machining is something for them. On the other side, it will not be the last machine you buy if you seem to like the CNC experience. In that case, there will be a moment that you are going to look for a machine with more performance. For under $200, you have a machine that you can assemble yourself within a few hours, and if you are into building things like I am, it's a fun experience. The Goebbels software is very minimalistic and easy to learn for beginners, especially if you compare it to Mach 3 that comes with the bigger hobby routers, with its insane amount of settings and features. Milling aluminium is kind of possible, but don't expect too much from it. It's a fun experience to try, and if your goal is to make holes or cut out shapes, then this machine can be useful. Don't keep your hopes up for any acceptable kind of surface finish. When engraving and milling soft materials like wood and acrylic, or if you want to engrave PCBs, this machine is in its element. A big advantage is how light this machine is. You can easily pick it up with one hand, and it's small enough to stow on a shelf. So if you're searching for a heavy duty machine to work on aluminium and steel all the time, this is probably not the machine for you. Are you searching for a fun little machine to learn about CNC milling, get experience with the milling software and make some great things without spending a lot of money, then this is a good choice for you. If you are new to this channel and you like CNC, 3D printing, metalworking, Arduino projects and more tech stuff, consider subscribing by clicking the subscribe button. Thanks for watching, until next time.